Thank you very much, Lavinia and Matteo, for this great opportunity to present my work here. This is a joint work with Davide Del Prete, who is also in the audience. So please, for any clarification question, refer to him. And I'm Nur Rahman from the World Bank. So the title of my presentation is Firms Amid Conflict: Performance, Production Inputs, and Market Competition. So we know that conflict affects the life of millions of people around the world. This is no surprise to us here today. And we also know that there are large economic impacts of conflict on economies around the world. What we know a bit less is exactly how conflict affects the function of firms, so the microeconomic aspects of the effect of conflict is much less understood, even though there is obviously a super interesting literature that we know, we are aware about. And what we do in this paper is exactly trying to contribute to this small but growing literature, and we study the effect of conflict exposure on firm performance in Libya. So why Libya? We know, unfortunately, that Libya is the place where a conflict, which is super important from the geopolitical point of view, is taking place at least since the end of the Gaddafi regime. And this conflict then had a second reboot during the Second Civil War, which started in 2014. The economic stability of Libya has important implications, not only for Libya itself, but also for neighboring countries. So understanding what happens to the private sector in Libya, which contributes to economic stability of the country, is of utmost importance for other countries as well. While this is obviously something relevant to be studied, unfortunately, there are big challenges to do so. And in particular, the challenge, as is often in these cases, is related to data. There are no micro data since 2014 for Libya, and there are no official data since the beginning of the first conflict in 2011. So that is obviously related to the very unstable political situation and the conflict situation all around the country. So the aims of this paper to fill this gap, and we do that trying to study the effect of conflict and exploring the underlying mechanisms, combining some new data. In particular, we use a retrospective panel data set of Libyan private firms that we collected in collaboration with the World Bank in 2018, and we combine that with geolocalized data on conflict events during the Second Libyan Civil War. So this is the one-slide paper. So the results that I will show you are the following. So we find that conflict exposure reduces firm revenues, which is not very surprising for the audience today, I understand. What is a bit less obvious is that we have some evidence that this effect is non-linear. And in particular, we try to provide evidence that this relationship is in fact convex. And we explain, we account for this relationship, this convex relationship, describing two competing mechanisms that we argue are at work in the Libyan case. The first one is production input mechanisms. So we document that conflict reduces the number of employees and reduces the availability of intermediate inputs available to the firms. And this has obviously a negative effect on the firm performance, measured in different ways. But we also have some evidence of what we call a market competition mechanisms. We show that conflict reduces the number of competitors to the firm, and this way it also increases the market share for surviving firms. So this has a positive effect, combined with the previous one, can lead to this convex relationship that we will show you later on. So this is what we are gonna do. But before going there, we want to give you a bit of background on two important elements. The first one is the Second Libyan Civil War that, as I told you, started in May 2014. This is a very chaotic conflict. It's a conflict in which essentially there are two rival governments, each supported by different militias that fight for the control of the country, in particular of the political power of the country. So the political analyst, I've done a lot of work trying to understand all the dynamics of this conflict, but it's really chaotic. This is one definition I found to describe this conflict, which is fought in the streets and even in residential neighborhood. And it has been very, very violent. Since 2014, there have been at least 12,000 fatalities in the country. The second element that I want to give you as a background concern what we are studying. So essentially, what is the Libyan private sector, which are the main features? Essentially, it's a small sector. It represents less than 20% of GDP. Libya, obviously, an oil country. So in this is very similar to other countries in the same region. And in particular, this private sector is made up of firms which are mainly small, family-owned, and absolutely no exporting. So this is what we are going to study. And these are also firms that are highly reliant on import in terms of intermediate inputs like semi-processed products and machine and so on. And they are also strongly reliant on foreign wars. Consider that before the fall of Gaddafi, 20% of the Libyan labor force was made by foreign workers. So these are the two main elements of our background that will help us to understand parts of our results. So moving to the data, the first piece of data comes from this firm level data survey that was conducted in person in July 2018. And it is the first and only one since the start of the conflict. So we designed the questionnaire and we supervised the implementation of the survey in the country. We tried to interview 400 Libyan private enterprises. What we did was to get information retrospectively. So we were able to ask retrospective questions to cover the period 2013-2017, in addition to geolocalization and balancing sheet data. So what we are talking about here in terms of our sample? Our sample is 98% domestic. So these are very localized firms which do not interact much with foreign producers. In our sample, there are no oil or agricultural sectors firms. So we are only talking about firms which are not in the oil sector. And 70% of them are small and 80% medium and very, very few are large. 20% imported at least once. So they are much more, very much reliant on what is coming from outside in the country, and less than 1% export. Finally, 34% is family owned and there is a lot of foreign employment. The second piece of the evidence that we combine is the one related to conflict data. And obviously our first data set is the active data set that everybody knows in this meeting, which gives us the location, the date and the info on the conflict events that we are considering. But we also use as a robustness check and to explore some additional elements, another data set which is called ICEVS, which is a data set which is interesting because it reports any political interaction between social political actors. It is interesting because it provides, first of all, checks on the results using the active data set, but also because it allows us to explore other dimensions of the conflict elements, which are not necessarily those collected by the active data set. So we find that useful in terms of giving a larger overview of the role of conflict in determining the firm performance. And finally, we have some additional data. The first two are a cross-sectional survey conducted by World Bank before the conflict, so in 2008, and one which was again a cross-section, which was conducted in 2014. So they were collecting data before the beginning of the Second Civil War. So they were recalling data for 2013. And then we have some data on from PetroData for a position of oil fields and so on. And then we have some data also on prices. We'll come back on that at the end of the, more or less the end of the presentation. I see that there is a question. I don't know if I have to answer.
Yes, so it's a clarification question related to the data. Yes. So I can read it. It's from Sophie Hatt. She's asking, why not focusing on the oil sector? Can you account for interdependency between oil and private sector?
Okay, the reason for focusing on the private sector is because that was the idea behind the oil survey. So we want to understand the private sector. The private sector in Libya is not involved in the oil sector directly. Most of the oil firms are either foreign or state-owned. So we are focusing on, as I said, the small firms which are in the private sector. The second thing is that we try to understand a bit more how these are connected with the oil sector. We have some checks at the end of the presentation exactly related on how what happens in the oil sector may have impacted also firms through, for instance, the input usage of oil and so on.
Okay, and then I have a second question from Alexei Makarin, who is asking if surveying only the surviving firm is an issue for estimation, and could it be that the effects of conflict are more mild for that subsample?
Okay, obviously the sample selection is one of the issues of our paper. We have a slide there and we will have some good answers to Alexei. No, I'm joking. No, that is obviously an important point. Unfortunately, as I will tell you in a second, the problem is that there are no data direct data to, or say official data to which to compare our sample. We can do something, and we'll show you in a second what we can do. And then you tell me if we'll be convinced by what we do, which is more or less what can be done, unfortunately. Should I go on?
Yes, please.
Thank you for the question.
Sophie is happy with your answer.
Okay, thanks. So this is the map of Libya. The blue dots are the firms, the brown one are the number of events. As you can see, the conflict and the firms' location are not homogeneous around the country. Consider that, I don't know if you look, if you see my pointer, but the southern part of the country is totally deserted. So this is not a surprise that we have a few firms, but also a few conflict events over there. The larger part of the population is in the upper part of the country, where is the coastal area. So these are the biggest cities that were also firms are located, and also most conflict event takes place. So let's go to the empirical part. This is our baseline regression. We have a dependent variable, which in the baseline is revenues, but we also have as alternative measure for firm performance, labor productivity and profits. But we will also use the same specification also to study the use of intermediate inputs and employment, and also market share. So we regress this variable on a measure of conflict exposure, which is defined in the baseline as the total number of conflict events occurred in the 10 kilometers radius of the firm in the corresponding year. We obviously have also robust and check on this measure, but essentially it's a measure which tells us how many conflicts have occurred in the neighboring of the country. And then we have firm level fixed effect and year fixed effect to control for an observable. And we also have alternative specification, which we can include sector per year fixed effect, region per year fixed effect, and distance year fixed effect, and a combination of this. And results survive also in this very, very much more demanding specification. This is the baseline result. So in this table, I show you that a higher number of conflict events which have occurred in a 10 kilometer radius of the firm reduces revenues in different specification. The effect is negative and significant. And to give you an idea of the magnitude of this effect, 10 more conflict events actually reduces revenues by 1.4%, which in standard deviation means 21% of revenues. In terms of value, this is more or less $80-$50 with respect to the median sample revenues, which is not a negligible size. So the effect is significant also in economic terms. Obviously, as we were already saying, there are a lot of issues here related to the validation of our empirical strategy. The first one I know is sample selection. Now, as I told you, there is no information on population of firms in Libya, not now, but in the last 10 years. So what we did was the following. Actually, in our sample, there are 26 firms which were also interviewed in 2014, which was the last World Bank survey, which was a cross section. Okay. So 26 of these firms are also in our sample, okay? What we did was to check whether or not firms that have not been interviewed again in our sample, which were in the previous survey, were different from the ones that we were able to interview again, okay? And as you can see from this simple test on the differences, there is no significant difference between these that have been interviewed, so which have been survived for sure, with those that are not have not been interviewed again. Unfortunately, as I said, there is we think this is something important because this is the only other information that we have on private firms in Libya before our survey, but I understand that is something that one would should let's say that is what we can do. Okay. In any case, the differences are not significant, and what we also obviously, I'm ready to answer any other question on this, because I understand it is super important.
So we have you have a question from Giovanni Prarolo.
Yes.
He's asking, what about possibly large swings in labor supply during those years, as 50% of workforce is foreign and they might leave for Europe or origin country?
Okay. This is a very good point. Obviously, Giovanni knows very well the situation on migration in Libya. And most of that migration occurred before the second Libyan civil war. We are going to think about how to implement some information that we are getting on migration in our analysis. We have not done that yet, but this is surely an important point that we will consider as a next step. So we are, I'm also working on migration in Libya, so I have some data that I can try to combine this. Thank you, John. The second thing I want to say on the data is that data quality issues about non-reporting and retrospective bias. Again, obviously someone may ask, since our panel is a retrospective panel, so it's not really a real panel, what we can say again here is to exploit some information related to that previous survey. And what we can say is that there is one question which is asked in that survey in 2014 in our survey. So both our survey ask data on revenues and other variables in 2013. So we can check whether our question in 2013, our answer is different from the one that was given by the same firm in 2013. Okay. And the difference is not significant. So essentially, when the same firm is asked again about the revenues in 2013, the difference is not statistically different. And this is comforting in terms of the reliability of this retrospective data, at least in our view. So other important threats to our identification strategy are obviously measurement error. And in that, as I told you, we do our best using an alternative data source and excluding international publisher from the accurate data to account for possibly differences in reporting the events. And then we have in the paper a lot of discussion about the issue of omitted variable bias. And what we argue is that we don't see a role for foreign worker presence or trade shock, which are sources of omitted variable bias that have been discussed in previous papers. And we also have some evidence that this is not related to the characteristic of the firm's location, in particular differences between being located in a very large city or a small city, because our results are robust to the inclusion of only very big city and only not very big cities. And we also have a discussion on the role of the location of oil fields in terms of possible elements with influences our estimates. So I'm not sure how much time I have because of the, in any case,
you have 10 minutes more, a bit more than 10 minutes, and then okay. We have the general discussion.
Okay, let's say that we if anyone is interested, I can come back obviously on the point about oil fields location, and this may be an issue for our analysis. And then we have also a discussion about reverse causality. We begin there emphasizing the characteristic of our sample, which somehow reduces the concern about reverse causality in terms of economic activity determining conflict intensity. We also provide some evidence that there is no targeting of firms in terms of possibility of protection by the firm themselves, and that the number of events are not predicted by local economic conditions. Obviously, I have a lot of discussion on this, and maybe we can come back to that later. And we do our best to check for the pre-trends. As I told you, previous data are not really available, so we try to combine night lights and other sources of data which are pre-conflict to show that there is no correlation between pre-conflict economic condition and the number of events that have occurred during the conflict in each area. And also that revenues do not decrease before exposure to conflict events for the firms in our sample. We did a lot of other robustness checks in terms of distances of the conflict, alternative conflict data, and sample composition. So for instance, we excluded the outliers, firms that have moved. And we also use the panel span, and the results are very consistent. Then we have a set of additional results in terms of outcome, and in particular, labor productivity and profits. In both cases, we find a negative effect, but that is significant for labor productivity, while is mildly non-significant for profits. And we also explore a bit the types of conflict events in terms of differences in the effect. We find that the effect is larger when the events include occur with fatalities and if the perpetrator is from ISIS. Interestingly, we don't find any effect when we consider protests. So this is suggesting that what we are capturing is probably really related to the conflict situation. In terms of heterogeneity, we find that the negative effect increases a bit with the firm size. So larger firms are marginally more affected, but there are no differences in terms of labor productivity, which is something interesting on which I will come back at the end of the presentation. And finally, probably the most interesting results, that is non-linearities in the effect. So the motivation for exploring this aspect comes from the qualitative evidence that we have in our survey, because a lot of respondents told us that some respondents told us that the conflict created new opportunities for their firms. So to account for this, we first re-estimated our molar using a non-linear specification. So we use above and below median number of conflict events and also the quartile distribution of conflict events to re-estimate our model. And so what we find is that the effect of conflict is marginally decreasing in intensity. So there is a decrease in the effect of a conflict as the level of conflict intensity is high. We also try a quadratic specification. So we test a convex relationship between conflict and firm performance. And we find that this is found in the data for revenues, labor productivity and profits. While it's not always super robust, we see that it has some important insights to give us. And finally, to account in a very flexible way of these non-linearities, we also estimate a semi-parametric model. This is the graph for one of the specification. This is the one which we also exclude the outliers. And so as you can see, there is some evidence of this convex relationship that we want to explore more in exactly the next section. Can I go on? I don't see if, okay, thank you. So to be quick, the next step obviously is to understand why we find this negative effect and this problem also nonlinear effect in the conflict on firm performance. And we essentially consider two main channels. The one is what we call the production inputs, and the second one is market competition. And then I will try to exclude some other potential mechanisms. So the first one is summarized in this table, in which we show that the higher number of conflict events the firm is exposed to, the lower the expenditure in intermediate inputs and the lower expenditure in labor, while there is no effect on fixed value asset. This is explored a bit more in the next slide, in which we show that the higher number of conflict events is essentially positively correlated with the firms reporting disruption of supplies. And then in the last two columns, we show that higher conflict exposure reduces the number of suppliers and the per supplier expenditure is not affected, which we interpret together as evidence that probably the adjustment has made through the number of varieties to which the firms has access to. So the number of suppliers decreases and this, because the expenditure does not, this probably implies a reduction in the varieties that are available to the Libyan firm for production. We have a bit more details on imported inputs, but we don't have time now to go through that. The second production input that we consider is, as we said at the beginning, is labor, in which we show that higher conflict exposure actually does not seem to affect labor cost or wage at the individual level, but it reduces the number of employees. And in particular, this effect is larger for foreign workers, while skill composition doesn't change. So why am I saying that here there is nothing really new? I mean, it's, we document it in a very difficult context, but this effect on production input is something that we may expect. We think there is something more to be said on the market mechanism that we, competition mechanism that we are exploring here. So as I said, we find some evidence that there is non-linearity in the effect of conflict on firm performance. Now, the hypothesis that we want to test somehow with our data is that this convex relationship between conflict and firm performance is actually driven by a reduction in the number of competitors. Unfortunately, as I said, we are very data constrained, but we do our best to provide some evidence of this mechanism to be at work. So what we show is that conflict reduces the number of competitors, but I have to be very clear with you, we can do that only for 1 year. And so the number of observations is very small. I don't want to oversell this, but what we find is that the number of competitors exiting the market in the last 5 years of the conflict is influenced by the number of community events that have occurred close to the firm, okay? And it is also stronger the effect when we consider intensity above the mean for this variable. The second step is to show that the negative effect of conflict on firm performance essentially is mitigated when more competitors exit the market. And we show this in this table, which the first two columns have as dependent revenues again, and we interact the number of conflict events with this measure telling us whether or not competitors have exited the market. And as you can see, in these two columns, the effect, the interaction effect is positive in both type of ways in which we code this reduction number of competitors, suggesting us that the negative effect on revenues is mitigated when more competitors exit the market. And we have a very similar result when the dependent becomes market share, which is another variable that we have in our data set, and which is very important to us because We next use this market share variable, which is a proxy for market competition, to explore more this non-linearity. So what we do is that we provide evidence that there is a quadratic convex relationship between market share and conflict intensity, and the relationship is quite sharp here. So this is a market share and conflict events on the horizontal axis. So this non-linearity is there, and the convex relationship again when we consider market share. And this is very robust, differently from, as I told you, other outcomes, but for us it's important to emphasize this because market share is a very important likely proxy for market competition. And most importantly, we use this quadratic relationship to test for some heterogeneity, because we want to understand a bit more who are the firms for which this convex effect comes in, who are the firms for which there is this positive effect in terms of reduction in market competition once the conflict is very strong. And we find that essentially this convex relationship holds for firms which are small and for which the ownership status is family. So these are small firms, family owned, while this difference doesn't seem to be significant in terms of differences in productivity levels. We try to interpret this as in line also with other previous results showing that there was no difference in terms of the effect of conflict by productivity levels, saying that probably the shock associated to conflict does not necessarily select the best one in terms of productivity, as one may assume. So there is something peculiar in terms of the way in which market competition evolves with conflict intensity, and this is something that we are trying to document somehow in this context. So the last
very quick clarification question. Yes, sure. And then so from Vasily is asking, could you remind how do you define who competes with whom based on locality?
Yeah, it is self-reported information. We don't know. So this is what the firms self-report in the survey. They give us the number of competitors.
Okay.
We have been working on trying to construct some proxy for the sector level of competition, but it's very tough because of the number of observations that we have. Anything else?
There are two other questions, but better suit for the final discussion. So
okay, I'm almost there. So the last slide was a summarizing slide of the attempts to exclude at least some other possible channels, mechanisms. The first one is obviously demand. Again, we are very data constrained here. What we can say is that looking at the data that were available at the market level for a number of cities in Libya for the period 2017-2018, we don't find any evidence of a reduction in prices. So essentially we see that where there is more conflict, prices increase, which is at least at odds with the idea that revenues decrease because consumer demand goes down. We have some more analysis also in terms of the demand from firms that I'm not reporting here, but they still point in the direction that there is no really a demand channel explaining the effect that we find. And then, as I anticipated at the beginning, we have also a bit of discussion about oil production. And what I can tell you is that essentially oil and gasoline are a very small part of the median cost in terms of raw materials, intermediate goods for these firms. And at the same time, we can check how much value of oil used in production is affected, is not significant. So there is no correlation, at least direct correlation, between what goes on in the oil production sector and the performance of the firm in terms of the channel through conflict. And finally, something that is very common to be discussed in this kind of countries, the relationship between corruption and illegal activities and conflict. Again, these are self-reported information. Open on this, but what we find is that perceived corruption is not correlated with the conflict exposure, at least in our sample, and also that illegal payment requests are more common for firms located in more conflict exposed location, which is something that we expect, but when we include this information in our regression, nothing changes. So they are not affected by conflict exposure, they do not impact on the performance in terms of revenues or other variables that we have. I'm done with the last slide. So what I hope to have shown you is some novel quantitative evidence of the effect of conflict on firm performance and on the mechanism explaining this effect. So what we have shown you is that there is a negative effect, which is economically significant, but also that the relationship between conflict intensity and firm performance is convex, or at least is non-linear. And this is important because it allows that there are mechanisms that probably are opposing one each other in this context. And these two contrasting mechanisms are on one side, the negative effect coming from the production input mechanism. So conflict reduces the number of foreign employees and reduces the availability of imported intermediate inputs. And on the other side, there is this potentially positive effect due to the reduction in number of competitors, which increases the market share for surviving firm. So giving them some advantage in terms of firm performance. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I can go back since we have the time for a final discussion to some questions you got. Sophie Hatt asked, what is the rationale for summing the conflict events? Like, are they comparable in nature? It was related to the first results, set of results you showed.
Yeah, definitely this is an important question. So as I told you, so this is the baseline, so the 10 kilometers. Okay, so we count all the events, but then, can you hear me? Yes. But then we have different data sources, and we also have different measure of distances and perpetrators. So for instance, I can show you, these are the results when we consider only ISIS, as I told you, or when we consider violent events, or only when there are civil protesters. So we try to explore a bit more, obviously, the heterogeneity in terms of the type of events that we consider. And this is detailed in the paper. Did I answer the question?
Yes.
So I was saying just that there is a lot of discussion about the type of events that we use and in a way in which we can combine them to also in terms of distances for which we count them in terms of location around the firms.
Okay, of course now who has questions can turn on their microphone.
Okay.
I can also like another questions from Pamela, you got. So what type of industry these firms are in? This might help you to go dig deeper in the intermediate input story because some industry needs more foreign inputs, for instance, than others.
Yes. This is something on which we are try to work a lot. So just to tell you about the sample, so this is the composition of the sectors that we have, but it's important that within this sector, actually, most of them are essentially subsector which uses a lot of high-tech imported inputs. So we have, for instance, machinery for pharmaceutical or for medicine or for hospital and so on. So there is a strict link between that and the need for imported inputs. So if I have 1 second, I would like to show you what we have in terms of imported inputs. Okay, I'm getting lost, sorry. Here. So as anticipated, the large majority of intermediate inputs are imported. And so what we show is that higher conflict exposure actually reduces import for Libyan firms, which are importing from EU and MENA, while this effect is not significant from US and Asia. And this is interesting because we have some information on the type of goods that we are importing. And what we find is that those that are not importing anymore are both firms which are small and with low value added goods, which were exporting before to Libya. So for instance, we have information on a firm from Italy, which was selling doors and parts of doors, which is not exporting anymore because of the conflict. While firms very large, which are based in US and Asia, are not affected by this. So exporting from these countries doesn't stop because of the conflict. So which tells us something interesting also in terms of obstacle to export and conflict intensity. And so we also have some heterogeneity in terms of how conflict reduces import. We find that the effect is larger for younger firms, firms who have no access to credit, and firms located in the Haftar area. Now the Haftar area is the part of the country ruled by Haftar, which is the part of the country for which the government was not internationally recognized. Okay, so at some point the country was divided in two. One had a government which was recognized by UN, the other one was not, which is this Haftar area. Okay, so the negative impact of import is stronger for firms located in this area. This is what we can say about the import and the effect of conflict on importing intermediate inputs.
Does someone else have questions? Okay, I actually do have one. So according to the results you show, like firms have some loss in terms of revenues and other measures, but then there is an effect on competition, and then through the channel of imports, like less imports, that there might be some winners in there. So I was wondering whether you had an idea of the overall cost.
In our case, it's extremely difficult to make this type of calculation because of the sample is not representative. And we know, we know that is, representative in terms of what was done before us. So this is the only thing that we can check, but it's difficult to say how much this is representative in general for Libya. So estimation of impact and cost is a bit hard to do. We are gonna do that in any case, and we see if the number that comes up are in any way significant. In terms of if I understand well, you're also asking if that channel of import may advantage some local firms. If I get it right. Okay, this is super interesting, and we have looked for that. We know if a firm sells to another firm, okay? We don't know exactly what they sell because we don't have this information, but we know if they are selling to other firms. And what we find is that the effect is not strong because in fact, the private sector is not very interconnected. So these are firms that are very much connected to import to other firms outside, but the local economy is very much separated. So there is no this effect that one may imagine. So I reduce the import, these advantages some firms which are a supplier in the domestic market. Unfortunately, in the case of Libya, this positive additional effect does not materialize because these firms do not exist. So there are very few, they exist, but there are very few firms which serve the domestic firms, which are domestic. But this is an interesting point that we discussed in the paper a bit. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. And Pamela has a last question. Do you have some data on investment or negative investment of physical capital of these firms? Thinking that in a conflict case, it might be difficult to firms to resell their used capital.
Okay, we don't have so much detailed information on reused capital. We have some information on the value of fixed assets, and maybe we should dig more a bit in that. Our initial result is that that was not very much affected by conflict per se, while the other two production inputs were much more negatively impacted. But yeah, you are right, we should try to explore a bit more also that aspect. Maybe we can find something interesting also there. Yeah, thanks.
1 minute for one last question, just in case.
Yeah, sorry, Michele, I have just a suggestion, not really a question. I don't know if you know this paper of one of the brilliant Lavinia Scott or Augustin Tapsuba, where basically he has a paper where he tried to have a more, let's say, fancy and complicated way to capture and to measure the conflict, like a kind of measure of the risk of violence. The idea behind is not only to count, the number of events you may have in a buffer, but it's to take also account on when in a given year the events are taking place. So the idea behind that, if you have 10 events in January, it's not the same that if you have one event every month. So I do not expect.
No, thank you very much for the suggestion. We were exactly thinking about that yesterday with Davide, how to incorporate this possible differential effect in terms of accumulation at some point in time. It's not the same. And this is something that we definitely want to explore a bit more. Maybe next I will ask you the exact reference for the paper. Okay, thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you very much, everybody, for having listened to me.
And thanks a lot for your very nice
to the next one.
Excellent.
Yes.
Thanks.